Welcome everybody to Sacred Trinity Church. That's a wonderful start for our program today. And abolitionist writer Julia Ward Howe's Battle Hymn of the Republic, which was written in 1861 at the beginning of the American Civil War. It was inspired partly by the scene of troops hurrying from the north to southern battlefields. In contrast to the irreverent lyrics of the soldiers' song, her version is religious in theme, linking the Union cause with God's vengeance on the Day of Judgment. Of course, today on FA Cup final day, we've chosen this song for a different reason, for a different association. It's a song that has been adapted by football fans. In this case, it is used by Manchester United fans as Glory, Glory, Man United. I did once do a funeral where that was the song that we had to enjoy. If you are a City fan, don't worry, we will get to Blue Moon in a bit. Today I thought we would explore some of the music that's used by football fans, United and City, but others as well. I also thought we could think about some of the good things about being a football fan. For most of us, it involves a lot of disappointment and frustration. Perhaps occasionally interspersed with a little exhilaration and even possibly some triumph and ecstasy. Football can be very tribal, but it's also about community. It doesn't have to be about identifying against the other side, but can be about seeking solidarity with your comrades in your suffering together. We began with a Manchester United song, but I am not a Manchester United fan. I support West Ham, which gives me a great insight into defeat and disappointment. A few years ago, West Ham actually knocked Manchester United out of the FA Cup. And the next time that they met Manchester United in that cup, I got a ticket with the West Ham fans at Old Trafford. I was moderately optimistic. But as we watched the game together, Manchester United scored first. And then scored again. And then scored again. And then scored again. And then scored again. When the sixth Manchester United goal went in, the West Ham fans fell silent. It was humiliating. And then one joker in the crowd started up with a chant. 7-6, we're gonna win, 7-6, 7-6. And we all joined in, not with the remotest hope that it was gonna be true, but in some kind of defiance. At the end of the match, yes, it ended 6-0. The stadium started to empty. But the West Ham fans were held back. We weren't allowed to leave at the same time as the Manchester United fans. And so, at the end, there were several thousand West Ham fans all at one end of a very empty Old Trafford. And that's when somebody started up with that classic football song, usually used to taunt the other side when they're losing. You're not singing anymore, anymore. You're not singing anymore. You're getting a bit of my singing today. Theirs is better, isn't it? You're not singing anymore is, it was just a lovely moment of humour as there was nobody in the stadium to answer us back. We are now going to sing that song, but with the proper lyrics. Because that, in the way that football fans like to take a tune and use it, that is a classic Welsh hymn from the 18th century, originally written by William William and translated into English by Peter Williams. It's a cry of help to God. We'll stay seated, but please do join in. The words are on the back of your programme. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer. It's a classic football song, and like many, it was a popular song at one time and was adopted by West Ham for unknown reasons. It was written in 1918 by Joan Kenbrovin and John William Kellette, and speaks of the elusiveness of good fortune. It always seems to speak to the West Ham fan about disappointment and failure. But we sing it together, because whatever happens, we stick together. I'm forever blowing bubbles, pretty bubbles in the air. They fly so high, nearly reach the sky, then like my dreams, they fade and die. Fortune's always hiding. I've looked everywhere. I'm forever blowing bubbles, pretty bubbles in the air. I suppose that as a Christian, I have hope, but I also experience a lot of disappointment. And this song encourages us to perseverance, and when sung with others, to solidarity. We'll be listening to this, but first we need to restore some balance for Manchester, for local fans. We started with a Manchester United song, and now we'll have Manchester City's song, Blue Moon. It's written by Rodgers and Hart and has been covered by many artists. This arrangement is by Jay Althouse. These days, Manchester City are, well, they are the best team in England. I know I'm being, you know, I'm treading on eggshells here, but, and they are probably one of the best, they are definitely one of the best teams in the world. But when this song was adopted by their fans over 30 years ago, it was said by City fans that they only won once in a blue moon. And so that's the reason the song kind of became popular originally. It's not true anymore, because with the amount of money that's been spent on that team, they are winning most of the time. We'll see what happens this afternoon. But for now, blue moon.
Yeah.
Like being on the terraces with the West Ham fans, that's just how they sing it. So do think of me on Wednesday when West Ham play in the final of the Europa Conference League. We haven't won anything for over 40 years, so even though it's the third tier of European competition, we will be jubilant if we win it. Will we win it? I don't know. I'm not taking anything for granted. You never do as a West Ham fan. I titled this, this great sacred music, Beautiful Music for the Beautiful Game. And there are certainly moments in football where individuals and teams do incredible things, and there is great beauty. Dmitri Shostakovich, the Soviet-era Russian composer, once described football as the ballet of the masses. And there are in some games moments of elegance and grace that seem almost impossible. Some games pulse with excitement and skillful exuberance. Some games can be 89 minutes of tedium and mediocrity, with maybe one moment of sheer brilliance that leaves you breathless. There are many famous football quotes. I won't bore you with too many, but Bill Shankly, who was manager of Liverpool for 15 years, which is a very long time for a football manager these days, he steered Liverpool to success, created the really successful team of the 1970s. And he famously said, "Some people think football is a matter of life and death. I don't like that attitude. I can assure them it is much more serious than that." Do we agree with Bill Shankly? I'm not sure I do, but there is certainly a lot that we can learn from football. The importance of teamwork and perseverance in training as a player. The importance of solidarity and resilience as a fan. The ability to cope with disappointment and to not let hope die. We're going to listen now to probably the most famous football song, and is the one used by Shankly's team of Liverpool. "You'll Never Walk Alone" by Rodgers and Hammerstein. It's taken from their 1945 show Carousel. It's not a biblical story, but a classic tale of ill-fated love. The song has lived on as Liverpool's anthem for decades, with other English football teams incorporating the tune into their games as well. "You'll Never Walk Alone" has developed a new meaning since as a song of remembrance for the Liverpool club after the Hillsborough disaster of 1989, in which sadly 96 fans lost their lives. "When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain. Though your dreams be tossed and blown, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone."
Yeah.
This time we're going to sing the hymn that will be sung at Wembley this afternoon, Abide With Me. It was first sung at an FA Cup final in 1927. It's a hymn written by Scottish Anglican cleric Henry Francis Light. A prayer for God to stay with the speaker throughout life and in death. It was written by Light in 1847, as he was suffering from tuberculosis. It's said that they may well have started writing it some years earlier, when a friend of his lay dying and kept saying to Light from his deathbed, "Abide with me." Light allegedly wrote the song at the time of his friend's death, never shared it with others. But he left the song with a friend when he moved to Nice for his health. He retired from parish ministry and moved abroad to help with his tuberculosis, but he sadly died just a few weeks later. The hymn was first sung at his funeral. So in solidarity with all who struggle, and with a painful awareness of our own limitations, we sing, "Abide With Me."
Abide with me, for so soon.
So much for coming today. I hope you've enjoyed the music and the reflections. Huge thanks to our choral scholars, and especially to Juan, who has stepped in at the last minute because somebody else was supposed to be doing the conducting, but train strikes have prevented them being here. So you've done really well. I didn't say this at the beginning, but let's give them a big clap. We've got one more song to come. Do today though stay for a cuppa, if you want a cup of tea or coffee. If you would like to make a donation, there is the means of doing that at the back of church there, both in the old-fashioned way and in the contemporary way. We are going to finish today with When the Saints Go Marching In, arranged by John Rutter. This old hymn and jazz tune is widely used in a variety of sports, often with amended lyrics. It's the theme song for Southampton, who were originally formed as a church football team by St. Mary's Church, and so are known as the Saints. And most older football teams were either originally formed as a works team, Manchester United were, or a church team, such as Manchester City. This year, Southampton have been categorically the worst team in the Premier League by some distance. They have been relegated, but oh, when the Saints will still be their song and will be a reminder of the glory that is to come for all of us.
Thank you.